here to proudly welcome all of you to the first episode of Big Cats, the Inside Story. We have here with us Dr. Latika Nath. Hey Latika, how's it going?
I'm so excited to be doing this, the first of our conversations on Big Cats. So incredible.
Absolutely. FOMO No More welcomes you, and I'm sure that the worldwide audience is going to love the series with the 35 experts coming from 9 countries talking about 8 big cats.
Yeah, I think it's going to be really something else. It's the first time we've had everything come together like this.
Absolutely. 35 experts, 9 countries, 8 big cats. The making of this series has been a labor of love for us and for you. Latika, you need no introduction. You are a legend. Conservation ecologist, wildlife biologist, scientist, an author, a photographer, the first Indian and woman doctorate in tigers. Latika, your journey has been a spectacular one. Could you please tell us more?
So, Supriya, basically I'm a wildlife ecologist. I now do a lot of conservation photography. I'm an author. I do underwater photography as well. I've been a hotelier in my time, but a lot of the work I've done has been on looking at humans and wildlife and how they can live and cohabit spaces together. Covers a little bit about conflict resolution, but it also covers, you know, multiple use and sharing spaces between big wildlife and things. I work primarily with carnivores, the area of my interest, and of the carnivores, the cats. I've done work on species like the Arna. I've done work on political boundaries and their effects on transboundary migration of species. I've done work on species like the Gangetic dolphins. So that's a little bit about me. I've spent a large part of my life in central India, where I've worked with the tribal communities and the forest department at the grassroots level for wildlife conservation. So I'm really excited to be sharing this with you, and I know that you'll be wondering what I'm going to be talking about this morning.
Great. I can't wait to see your presentation, which I'm sure will be very interesting indeed for the world to see. Please start.
This is the first of the conversation on the cats, and you know, we've been through this incredible lockdown the world over, and I've been sitting and really mulling over what is happening in the world with cats. And what is it that I remember? What is it that I want to focus on? And I've been wondering what people are doing and trying to catch up with friends in the field. So the big cats that I've been really thinking about in the past few months has been the jaguar, the leopard, the lion, the puma, the snow leopard, the clouded leopard, and the cheetah. And I just wanted to take this opportunity to talk about big cat conservation as I see it in a global perspective. So the jaguar is one of the most incredible of the cat species. We have about 64,000 left in the wild. Then there is the leopard. And unfortunately, we're down to a mere 10,000 or less. We have pumas, which are about 50,000 or so in number. Snow leopards, we're not even very sure of. We think it's somewhere in the region of 10,000. Then you have clouded leopards, we think also somewhere around 10,000. Lion populations have been greatly decimated. We are now down to less than 20,000 lions in the world. And of course, the largest and the most powerful of the cats, the tigers, 3,900 or so in the last count. Cheetahs, those fragile, beautiful animals, under 7,100. So it's not been really, really good. And most of this has happened in the last 100 years or so. And a lot of the crash in numbers has happened in the last 10 years. But there's been some interesting news as well. For instance, the black leopard was discovered after nearly 100 years in Africa. In this photograph, this is Wilbarred Lucas, and he took this, and it's an incredible, incredible image in the Laikipia region of Kenya. We also had really exciting news from India, because we had tigers in the snow, and this is the first record we have of tigers in the snow in India. And you know, these tigers are found in Arunachal in the Mishmi Hills. This is a photograph taken by the Wildlife Institute of India when they were doing their record-breaking census. So really, really, really exciting. On the world front, equally exciting was the fact that the Asiatic cheetah is now due to come back to Iran after nearly 80 years. Now that is such positive news that one would think things are going really, really well. But what is happening? Let's look at what's happening on the other side of the coin. India was also preparing to give the Asiatic lions a second home. I begin with the lions for today because it's World Lion Day, and I think it's appropriate we talk about what's happening with these incredible beasts. Kuno was identified and prepared, and recently the Supreme Court has given an order saying that lions should get a second home in India. However, despite the orders of the Supreme Court and in contempt of the order of the Supreme Court, the Gujarat government is still resisting translocating lions to Kuno. And it is heartbreaking because this year we've not only had an overpopulation and spillover of lions becoming very, very obvious, but we've had a disease outbreak, and it has been absolutely catastrophic. If you look at this image, they found 21 lions someday and 11 Asiatic lions dead on another day, and it was too late. This is why we always say, don't put all your eggs in one basket. We need to have a second home for the lions. If they had only relocated these lions instead of letting them wither away, we would have had a second viable population of lions in India by now. So one of the conversations that we're going to be having is about lion relocation and what is happening with the Asiatic lion population, which is the only wild lion Asiatic population in the world, in India, in Gujarat. Moving on from there, there's been a lot of debate on trophy hunting. Is it good? Is it bad? What are the impacts? What is happening with, you know, the effects of lion hunting? Now, many people believe that culling is really, really essential, because if you don't cull, then you have spillovers like you've had in Gujarat, and you've got disease outbreaks happening. But it's a very, very difficult decision to make. So I think it's going to be really interesting talking to people like Les Carlisle and Adam Bannister about what is happening with lion conservation and big game hunting and tourism for protecting lions in Africa. Okay, now coming back to it's been a very tough time for Asiatic cheetahs because there's less than 100 of them left in the world today. The only known populations are in Iran. In India, they went extinct in the 1950s. Today, the Supreme Court has given orders for the reintroduction of the cheetah in India. There's been a huge furor and debate about this, with some people feeling that it's going to be the much needed shot to renew interest in grassland conservation, which is going to affect and preserve species like the Great Indian Bustard. There's been new research recently which shows that the Southeast African cheetah is very closely related to the Asiatic cheetah. And the research also shows that the divergence of cheetahs did not take place 5,000 years ago, as is the common conception, but actually took place 72,000 years ago. Wow. So this is really, really an incredible new finding. And one of the conversations that we're going to be having is with Dr. Ranjit Singh and Dr. Divyabhan Chawla and Elena from the Mara Meru Project, talking about cheetah reintroduction in India and how it is really, really special. At the same time as, you know, all of this excitement about cheetah reintroduction, there's been a very sad event that happened in the world this year, and I think we need to talk about them because these are a group of researchers who've been working on Asiatic cheetah conservation and in Iran. And the government of Iran arrested all of these people and put them into prison and accused them of being spies. This has been a real blow to the wildlife science community, and many wildlife scientists have been hugely shaken up by what has happened. So remembering this team in Iran and lending their support, we are with you. We are with you, and we have complete solidarity with what you're doing. Cheetah conservation is not just about reintroductions. It's also talking about what is happening in the world. And one of the saddest things that's happening is the huge trade in live cheetah cubs. People go into the field and they kill the mother, or they steal the cubs away and they smuggle these because there's a huge demand for cheetahs as pets. The Asiatic cheetah is almost wiped out. They feel that there are now only about 30 animals left in the wild. And there's been a huge, huge, huge demand for cheetahs as pets. The first picture, the black and white one, is actually from Ethiopia, and it's one of the last kings of Ethiopia. But the demand continues today, and in the Middle East, people still want cheetahs as pets, which is absolutely horrific. So not only are cheetah facing demands because of the demand for pets, but there's also been a lot of hunting of cheetahs, legal and illegal. And this has been absolutely heartbreaking, because when you have 7,000 animals left in the world, the last thing you want to see is illegal hunting of cheetahs and populations being wiped out because farmers and rangers and landowners have been protecting their domestic cattle from cheetah hunts. Cheetahs also have a huge problem because they're the weakest of the carnivores. So they get predated on by lions, by leopards, and even get bullied and killed by hyenas, or, you know, on a chance occurrence by even something like a crocodile. So my friend Laurie Marker has been doing the most amazing work for cheetah conservation. And Dr. Elena has been working for about 15 years in the Mara Meru project in Kenya. And they talk about cheetah conservation in these series. Elena talks to us about all of the work that she is doing to sensitize communities to living with cheetahs. Laurie, of course, did this incredible work by introducing the big livestock guarding dogs, which are the Anatolian Shepherd dogs, and she's absolutely turned the tide for cheetahs in Namibia. So we need to discuss all of these with Elena, with all of the people on cheetah conservation, and get all the news from them. Now, going across continents, we're going to come to the next species, which I've been very, very lucky and very fortunate to have seen not too long ago, the puma. The puma, the cougar, the mountain lion, a cat with many names, was doing very well in Patagonia, but recently there's been a lot of tourism-related pressure on the area, and the protection given to these animals is fueling conflict with the ranchers from the region. Often ranchers will kill puma and protect their cattle. Tourism. There has been a emergence of extraordinary lodges and accommodation providers in the region to ensure that your experience with Puma conservation in places like Torres del Paine is life-changing. But Puma conservation is not only based in that part of the world. There are pumas all over the Americas. And recently there was local extinctions in puma populations on the eastern side of North America. Luckily for us, the eastern and western populations of puma are the same. So the reintroductions are being planned to try and get back pumas into these areas. So this series, we're going to have a conversation with Rodrigo Moraga Zuniga on puma conservation, and he is from Chile. Amongst all of the exciting stuff that happened recently was Steve Winter's work on leopards and their lives in India. Now, this is an incredible image that Steve took in Mumbai, showing a leopard walking on the road in front of a very densely habitated building in Mumbai. You know, in the lockdown, we've been seeing that there are leopards everywhere. You get news from across the country that because people were going and staying indoors, leopards suddenly found it okay to come out and be visible in the day. So what we didn't realize is that we cohabit all our spaces with leopards, and they are so successful at remaining silent and remaining hidden and not getting in our way. Unfortunately, what's also happening is that there's been a lot of conflict with leopards when they come out. And there's been absolutely deadly human and wildlife losses with humans getting injured and hurt and leopards always getting killed. So we're going to be talking to experts like Dr. Vidya Atreya, like Jaisal Singh, understanding how leopards and humans cohabit in India and how we can improve leopards, the chances of leopard survival in a country like ours. Now, it's not only the leopards that are coming out, it's also species like the lions. I told you they're spilling over, and you look at these images. They've come out in Junagadh. You see them walking on the docks, you see them on roads. It's, you know, wildlife coming out in a big way. I'd like to move on to another species. This is the snow leopard. The snow leopard exists across the all ecosystems and habitats in the Himalayas. It is our umbrella species. Snow leopard is an animal that cannot be restricted to any one national park. It roams across political boundaries and it has an incredible story to tell. To tell the story of snow leopards, the impacts of climate change on habitat destruction and poaching is a group of really exciting people. We have Dr. Kaustubh Sharma, who's been working on snow leopards for most of his career. We have people like Surya Ramachandran, who've been working on snow leopard and tourism. And we also have Gautam and Doyle Pandey, who've been making an extraordinary film on the snow leopards in the Himalayas. The snow leopard is perhaps one of the species where we have seen very, very positive changes that have been brought about because of tourism coming in. So this is a story where the creation of homestays have given people an alternate livelihood, and people are now beginning to tolerate the loss of their domestic animals to snow leopard predation, because they get revenue and income from photographers and tourists interested in seeing the tourism. So all of this is going to be discussed in these stories. The most elusive of our the smallest of our big cats, the big small cat called the clouded leopard. The clouded leopard has been something that we know very, very little about. It was very exciting because in 2007, they found, due to all of the genetic work that they were doing, that there is actually a new species of clouded leopard in Borneo. And we're going to get somebody who's a master photographer, a Canon ambassador, Shivang Mehta, talking to us about his experiences in trying to find and study the Bornean clouded leopard. We've also got Priya Singh talking to us about her work in India and, you know, the incredible discovery of clouded leopards in Langkang National Park in Nepal, which is the furthest we've seen it at this end of its range. So Priya has done lots of work in Northeast and she will be talking to us about what's happening there. Now, the clouded leopard has been intensively poached and trapped and snared in many parts of his range, especially in places like Cambodia. And what's shocking to me is that there are actually reports from friends who work in WWF there and in the media that rangers found as many as 100,000 plus snares in one forest to catch this animal. This is unbelievable, unacceptable, and mind-boggling. How do you even deal with this issue? So talking about all of this and more will be Christy Williams and a whole lot of other people from WWF, and they work in Myanmar, in Cambodia, and many of the other places where you have clouded leopards. Recently, there's been much talk about what's been happening in the Amazon. Before the whole lockdown and the pandemic happened, the forest fires of the Amazon were a hot topic of debate. Jaguars are the tigers of South America, and they're more or less extinct from North America now. But jaguars have always been hunted and poached and killed for protecting ranches and the cattle. And there's been a lot of conflict between landowners and jaguars. This continues till today. And even though populations have been drastically and dramatically falling, we haven't been really able to do too much about this. Images, show you what is going on. Now, it's not only the trade in jaguars that is the problem, but also what is happening with the habitat destruction in the Amazon. And to refresh people's memories, these are images of forest fires in the Amazon. And these fires continue to burn, and it's been a really, really, really impossible task to control what is happening. Images from NASA in the slide on the right show you what these forest fires look like from the sky and just how much they have spread. So the loss of habitats is proving to be a huge issue in Amazon, not only because of the fires, but also because of deforestation that is happening legally and illegally in this region. But it's not only the Amazon forest fires that is the issue. There's also habitat loss due to, converting millions of acres of forest into agricultural cropping, which could be fodder for cattle. It could be palm oil. It could be even shifting cultivation in a lot of parts of the world. And half of the world's ecosystems today are under threat from habitat loss or from desertification and climate change. So I think we're going to be really looking forward to a lot of interesting information on all of these subjects from people and speakers in this series of conversations. Coming to the tiger, the recent huge uproar that we have completed our task well ahead of time. We've doubled our population 2 years before 2022, which was our goal, and we've made our statement to the world. However, we've got only 3,000 tigers. is that really enough? Is that what we are going to be telling people? Is this a time for complacency, or are we going to go ahead and try and increase numbers? All these questions and many more related to tiger conservation will be handled by over 6 or 7 of India's topmost tiger conservationists in these conversations. We'll be talking about poaching across the range of the tiger, not only in India, but all of the 13 range countries that tigers are found in. We'll be talking about what is happening with tigers when they're kept as pets, and what happens when tigers and humans conflict and clash. In these images, you see what happens when tigers come into villages and they get killed almost every single time. And it's not just the tigers who get killed, but there have been many incidents of humans getting killed because of tiger attacks. And this is of great and serious concern, especially in countries like India. And we will be talking about what we can do to minimize this conflict. If you look at the news, you will see there's been a lot of media coverage about this, and there's been a lot of data collection on what we can do to minimize human-tiger conflict. Now, talking tourism, tourism and wildlife tourism and tiger tourism in India has always been something that a lot of people are dependent on and discuss, and it's what brings the world into India to see wildlife. Wildlife tourism is a growing phenomenon. There's been a lot of interesting research studies on this, and we'll be talking about all the work that she has done with Kriti Karan on tiger tourism and minimizing tiger-human conflict. There's also been a surge in sustainable tourism movements in India. We'll be talking to many tourism experts like Shobha Mohan, Ali Rashid, Les Carlisle, talking about what people are doing for promoting sustainable, responsible tourism in India. Of course, not to forget that there's been a debate on the use of elephants for safaris, on carrying capacities for vehicles, and how the Supreme Court actually stopped for a time tiger tourism altogether and have impacted the way we deal with tiger conservation in India. Now, conservation has changed from the time when I started. We now use a lot of technology to talk about conservation, and we use technology like night vision cameras, infrared cameras, camera trapping. The forest department uses drones, and we have these lovely little robo cameras which you can use to go right up to lions and big cats and tigers and get insights into their lives in a way that had never been possible before. So we'll be talking about the use of technology as well, which is hugely exciting. Another huge game changer for conservation awareness is the use of photography to spread a message about the conservation of a species. Incredible photographers like Shiva Mehta, like Rodrigo, like Nick Brandt have all been using their photographs through magazines like National Geographic, Discovery, Travel and Leisure, Condé Nast, Outlook, and so many more to convey a stark message about the reality in the field. These photographs say things that words can never ever share. And the impact of these photographs is just amazing. So this is using photography to make statements about conservation. A growing place of concern is development projects and their impacts on big cat conservation. There's been an increase in road kills because increasingly highways and state highways are being constructed without taking into account what is happening when the habitats get split into two. There's been a huge spike in roadkill, especially of big cat. We will be talking about what we can do as mitigative strategies, how we can make overpasses and underbridges, what impacts they have on wildlife, and just how effective they are to help conserve wildlife. Human-wildlife conflict, again, across all species. There'll be people talking about these. What is happening? Is it on an increase? Is it on a decrease? What can we do about this? Now, of course, a very, very important area is zoonotic disease. We're still struggling to come out of the latest lockdown and pandemic, which is COVID-19. We will have a section talking about how zoonotic diseases spread from animals to humans, what we can do about these, and to remember that COVID is not the only one. We've had the SARS, we've had a whole lot of other diseases which we've always dealt with. We need to be prepared to deal with these on a global level and not ever go into this situation again. But it's not only diseases like SARS and COVID that we need to worry about. It's also things like rabies, which are being spread by huge uncontrolled feral dog populations. And expert after expert, species after species, you've seen the impact of feral dogs coming in. So much so that a feral dog actually bit a tiger's tail in Panna, and the feral dog had rabies, and they were really, really worried about what was going to happen to this tiger that had been bit by the dog. It's not only rabies, it's also diseases like distemper and parvo and a whole host of other issues that come up through these feral dogs transmitting pathogens to wild populations. Now, the future for India is actually rewilding. There's been a huge amount of debate on that in the last decade or more. And rewilding is all about reintroducing animals to areas where they've been into, local extinctions, and we've lost species. India has successfully reintroduced tigers into many of its parks. We're now talking about the reintroduction of the Asiatic lion, but they've also reintroduced lions into places like the Akagera National Park, into Malawi, all over the world. And we're going to be listening to people like Dr. Pabla and Les Carlisle about reintroductions in India and the impact that it'll have on species' long-term sustainable survival. Now, relocations will not only take place of animals into parks, but also moving people from within parks to outside parks to create inviolate core areas for the survival of species where they are left undisturbed from human activity. Ramesh Pratap Singh is an incredible forest official who's been responsible for much of the relocation that has happened in the last 10 years in a state like Madhya Pradesh. He'll be coming to talk to us about relocation of villages, the challenges, and how we can do all of this work, and the success stories, and how he has created new tiger habitat using these relocations. So that's it for me. I just wanted to play this little video for you and remind you.
I will give a quick update on the ecology of the species, but more importantly, focus on the conservation issues that we have.